two provisions outside of the West from within the West for many, many centuries. Arguably, Plato himself was influenced by the mystical traditions of ancient India. In the 17th century, famously, Leibniz, the philosopher, grew on strands of Confucianism and Neo-Confucianism for his methodology. And also, right, the East even was very important in the West, having access to their own traditions. So, for example, we would not have studied Aristotle in this course were it not for certain Islamic scholars who transposed and worked on the text of Aristotle, basically saved the text of Aristotle for the world, because the record of Aristotle, the record of the text, were lost from the Western tradition throughout much of the early Middle Ages. So there are various ways in which the East has, Middle East, the Far East have had influence on Western theory. So then the question is, what drives the current and perhaps more self-conscious attention to what is called comparative political theory today? And of course, partly due to the question of challenges to Western hegemony in the world, partly questions of multiculturalism within the West. So there seems to be a need to delve a bit more deeply into questions of competing traditions and the continuities and contrast between these various traditions. And certainly scholars have managed to provide quite interesting insights, particularly in comparisons between ancient China and ancient Greece. And of course, the study of Confucius is central to that task. It's particularly interesting in the current juncture of Western philosophy and political theory because, as I said, overcoming challenges of multiculturalism and helping to think through Eastern traditions by reflecting on their place within a broader moral framework. So some of the more practical questions, for example, that arise or that have driven these issues or that arise from these issues is the question of how degree of moral relativism or not. So some of you may know that in the end of the last century, into the 90s, there was this big discussion about Asian values and whether, you know, the West treats Asia with a different sort of set of norms. There were certain leaders in the East, particularly from Singapore, who suggested that Eastern nations should be treated according to sort of different standards. So is there a question of certain moral relativism within a global framework? Or should traditions in the world be subject to the same exact norms and expectations of the West? Or is there a third path, right, whereby certain recognition of individual protections and liberties can be said to be achieved, but through a different conceptual framework and institutional practice than those associated with Western liberalism? So there's just some really interesting and deep questions, right, involved in a lot of these issues. To what extent, for example, do conceptions of human rights as we develop from the Western tradition, do they apply, should they apply in non-Western contexts? Or can we think about whether the normative expectations of other contexts are equivalent to human rights but not human rights? How are those conceptualized, those standards, those judgments? There's a lot of really interesting and challenging questions in some of these issues. Now, from a perspective of questioning what resources Asian thought may offer a rethinking of Western traditions, Confucius offers us a theory that might allow us to make normative judgments about the world, about our duties and how we should act in the world, without any strong theory of metaphysics or robust claims about human nature or human essence. So on the surface, right, we might think that going back to Confucius is interesting because we might suggest that in a multicultural world such as we have in the West, we are resistant or hesitant, right, to bring in theories that have a strong conception of what human nature is or a strong sort of religious side to them or metaphysical side to them. So in the sense that Confucianism tends to be regarded as a more practical set of ideas, but with sort of a normative import, it may have an interest, right? It appears to show us a way to develop a theory that provides what we might find appealing about the ancient philosophy of Greece, and it's a theory that's focused on the most important questions of what it is to be a good human being. So Confucius, in that sense, shares with Plato and Aristotle basic questions of what it is to live a good life in society. But Confucius sort of abandons the heavy baggage of the Greeks in terms of talking about the essence of human nature and forms and the metaphysical gravity and all those things that make us more hesitant and cautious in terms of enlisting some of these ideas of Plato and Aristotle. Now, William Theodore Barry, a very important scholar of Confucianism from Columbia University, suggests sort of another way in which Confucianism is interesting for us in the West today, because he suggests that the background of community decay and anxieties over social decay in the West are also sort of the same background to the time that Confucius lived. So in a sense, right, he's dealing with some of the same concerns that from some perspective could be regarded as our own. And so his return to a demand of a form of self-cultivation in the midst of natural ties to the family can be seen as one possible response to political forces that are increasingly experienced as beyond our influence and control. So in a sense, right, the notion of rooting your sense of importance and virtue and loyalty and duty in the family is one way to respond to the sort of crisis of political alienation when your leaders don't seem to be acting or performing in the way that you would otherwise like them to. So there are other reasons why it's an exciting time in Confucian scholarships, and one is just related to basic archaeological evidence. So these are a picture of bamboo strips. These are strips that are probably much wider than a pencil. And there were about 3,000 of these pieces of bamboo found in 1993, so not so long ago. Some were from a newly discovered tomb. Some appeared at an auction in Hong Kong. But these were strips of bamboo that were dated to around the time, or slightly after the time of Confucius. And some of them attributed to his students, talking about conversations and interactions. It's interesting just to note, right, how things were recorded, right? Our modern equivalent to the internet, to writing things out of a notebook. In this time, the record equivalent to the time of Plato and Aristotle in ancient Greek were written on these very thin strips of paper. Now, these are being properly cared for and restored, so some of them, you know, were full of mud and so on, and so there's a lot of restorative work that has to go on with them before even some of the analysis takes place. Some of that research is coming out. But what's so important about these bamboo strips is that even the annalists themselves are post-dated. So the annalists which we read for today is something that was brought out in China after the life of Confucius. It's sort of reporting on what Confucius said by his disciples and passed down through the world. So much of what we have evidence of Confucius is much post-dated. It comes secondhand, much like obviously a parallel can be made between Confucius and Socrates in a way, but we don't have so clear a sort of disciple of Confucius as we have with Plato in relation to Socrates. So these bamboo strips come before the annalists were written. So we can compare the finding of these manuscripts to the finding of the Dead Sea Scrolls, to finding something like a new manuscript of Plato from around the time of the Plato action, you know, Rome or some new
title that was brought forward around closer to the time of his life. So it's a really sort of studying, discovering terms of Confucian scholarship and provides a lot of interesting resources for rethinking who Confucius was, what the tradition is, and so on. We might say also there's more significant timely geopolitical reasons to look at Confucius. Some of you may know that throughout the 19th century, the area that we generally call the Holy Asia was Confucianized. In other words, the daily practices of those living in China, Korea, Japan, Vietnam, were thought to be sort of infused with a general sense of Confucianism, and indeed the governments were legitimated through Confucian ideals, by the mid 20th century, when the communists became established in China, the tradition of Confucianism became the spread. Right? Confucianism was associated with the old order, with the old dynasty. And so particularly during the Cultural Revolution, Confucianism was thought to have legitimated repressive and authoritarian regimes. So there was a time in China when Confucianism was sort of outlawed. But since then, right, since about 2005, 2006, there's been a sort of return to Confucian, at least rhetoric, perhaps substance, in China. So for example, at the opening of the 2008 Olympic Games in Beijing, they had part of their ceremonies was a big theatrical presentation of the sayings of Confucius. There have been more appeals to Confucius in public rhetoric. There's been a bestseller in China, Confucius from the Heart, Yu Dan's, 2009. So there's been this sort of new resurgence of an interest in Confucianism in China. And so the question is, what does this mean, or what does it signify, or what is its potential? And given, of course, China's position, right, on the global stage and growing in economic power and influence and so on, there's an interesting question as to whether this Confucianism is significant of a sort of further endorsement of a continued authoritarian tradition as it had been in the past uses of Confucianism, or whether for future sort of use adaptation of the tradition, as some suggested, that Confucianism does provide resources for a sort of alternate liberalization of the Chinese regime. So there is that real question as to what Confucianism is doing in terms of the political development of China. Is it working towards opening up of the system to new practices of liberty, or is it a tool of the authoritarian leaders whose turn to Confucianism should be regarded with suspicion? So there's interesting geopolitical questions that we can ask. So as you go through Confucius, and particularly in relation to questions of authority, you might want to ask yourself, what are the potential here for a sort of liberalizing ethos, or is it more about mandating and justifying authoritarian structures? So it's of interest to turn to Confucius for a variety of reasons. Still, we must be cautious and careful because comparative political theory is a challenging enterprise. It's challenging because, of course, we are going beyond general practices of structures of comprehension. So we're seeing challenges to what in the West we find as basic categories of comprehension. And even like the words in translation, obviously there are challenges even from reading from the translation from the Greek, but still there's a sense in which Greek terms and Greek ideas have their meanings that sort of infused and distilled themselves into English in a certain way. So there is some continuity when we're talking about translations from ancient Chinese of this, 6th century BC. There are obviously questions of what words you use and how do you interpret that. So one has to be ready for greater barriers, right, to comprehension. So how is it that we do understand? Well, in broad terms, there are various theories about how we can even have access, right, to thought and language and thinkers of such a distance from us today. Some thinkers in political theory have used this notion of fusion of horizons, right, that we don't necessarily understand everything as a text from its own perspective and from its own period. But what we do is take our own horizon of understanding and meet somewhere halfway so that we can at least try to understand the text partly in our own terms and by using our own terms come to some understanding of what is being said there. So we can't necessarily expect to fully escape our own interpretive framework, but at least our framework may be modified by new ideas in the new framework. Of course, there's perhaps no one more influential than Confucius in the world, given Confucian dominance in the latter 19th century. So another challenge to interpreting Confucius through the Analects is to try to bracket, right, everything that Confucianism might have brought to the tradition, right? So we're trying to go back to the man, back to some of what can be considered the original pronouncements of the man, and not to necessarily get caught up or to consider what the tradition of Confucianism has said, much like some interpreters from the Western tradition will try to separate Marx from Marxism. I mean, there's some continuity, but there's also much more different directions in Marxism than we could potentially find in Marx. Similarly, we try to focus on the text and bracket what the tradition of Confucianism might have said. So we might ask the question, well, how do we broadly think about Confucius in relation to Plato and Aristotle? This is, of course, partly what we're doing in the course, is embarking on such comparisons to shed light on the both. And I'll be bringing up these parallels at several points within the lecture. We'll be looking at the fact that, of course, they come from roughly the same historical period. But if we're going to sort of schematize some of the ways in which we can compare and contrast the two, we might say that Plato sought to mold a state that could be governed by those trained to be the wisest. So we can perhaps see his notion of politics, or his notion of a state, in so far as it seemed to be instrumental, right? An instrument to the generation of the highest virtue and wisdom possible, right? So the leading goal, the leading objective in the Platonic universe is the development of the highest intellectual virtue, and the state is one stepping stone of doing this. In Aristotle, we saw the development of a political model where citizenship, especially in a better regime, was an expression of some of those highest or higher virtuous capacities of human beings, where the regime not only provided the backdrop for individual flourishing, but some of the activity necessary for a full life. So there's a slight distinction between Plato and Aristotle. What I'm trying to suggest here is that insofar as for Plato, you can see the political structure as somewhat instrumental, fully instrumental to the production of intellectualism, intellectual virtue. For Aristotle, the state of the political realm was partly a place where not only instrumental, but you were virtuous in the political realm. So the political realm was partly constitutive, right? The interaction with the deliberation and so on
that was an arena, and it was part of what Bridgie was, to act in reciprocity in a public arena. Now with Confucius then, contrasting here, we find a model of flourishing that's embedded in a strongly sociological vision of the world, where the better individual will have close ties to family and friends, but where opportunities for political service are uncertain, and where service to the state, while desirable, is not necessary for a vision of good character. So what we have in Confucius then is a sort of notion of the political that is neither instrumental to the development of goodness in the way that it is for Plato. We might say that the state is a necessary condition for, at least in terms of the Republic, a necessary condition for the development of the philosopher. For Aristotle, similarly, the political realm serves an important essential, it's essential condition for plenty of conditions, an essential place where virtue is enacted, right? Whereas in Confucius, right, we see the politics as, in some ways, more marginalized. We see that there is an element of the importance of the but it's not as central to the notion of what a good human being is. And so to that degree, right, even thinking of the farness of Confucius in terms of time and terms of culture and so on, there's a sort of funny ironic sense in which Confucius is closer to us than Plato and Aristotle, because I imagine that if I interviewed a lot of you in terms of your own conceptions of the good and the good life, most of you would suggest that, you know, the state is not necessarily an essential element to make you a good person, right? You can develop goodness in your personal ties and in your family. Maybe the state can help that in sort of little ways, but you're not going to see it necessarily as an essential condition, right, of your flourishing. And to that extent, that view that we see today, partly due to a sort of decline of faith in the political class and politics and what it can achieve, to some extent there are greater connections to our own views of the world and that of Confucius. Okay, so what do we know? What can we say about Confucius as historical figure? So here we have the comparative dates, right? Which are actually, you know, in terms of the long scheme of things, almost identical. Confucius living from 551 to 479 BCE, Plato born, I mean, these dates, obviously, there might be a give and take. These are not necessarily known, absolutely certain, but these are sort of ballpark figures of the years, roughly what you know. Plato, 428, so born roughly 50 years after Confucius died, 348, and then Aristotle, again, as a student of Plato, 384 to 322. This is also, just for perhaps curiosity's sake, a similar time to the period in which the Buddha lived and the birth of Taoism. And so the significance of this, right, the fact that we have Plato, Aristotle, Confucius, the Buddha, has led certain thinkers, and a German thinker in particular, a fellow called Karl Jaspers, to talk about this period as the Axial Age. Jaspers argued that during the Axial Age, the spiritual foundations of humanity were laid simultaneously and independently, and these are the foundations upon which humanity still subsists today. A sort of interesting commentary on the development of intellectual and religious traditions within humanity. So all the thinking emerging throughout the world at this time shaped in a profound way the subsequent history of these various civilizations. Now Confucius is known in China as the teacher before all other teachers. In fact, there's a certain day in China that's known as Teacher's Day, which is called sort of, I guess if you transpose the sort of European tradition of Saints Day, right? It's sort of the Teacher Day, the Confucius Day, the day when all teachers are celebrated in the name of Confucius.
Confucius was born in Lu State, which is the current day Shandong province in East China, somewhere roughly midway between Beijing to the north and Shanghai to the south. And Confucius was born into a family of relatively low status. And his life denotes the beginning of what is called in China the Warring States period. And that is a time when the dynasty, the Zhou dynasty, was in decline, and the territory of China was fragmented into a larger number of smaller states. So a sort of time in which there was political fragmentation, political decline, and conflict among these smaller states. This led to confused grounds as to what, you know, what were proper arguments or proper ways of establishing authority, how authority could be legitimated, questions about the best form of social and political organization, questions about how merit is best measured. So Confucius thought about these questions with a number of individuals from a diversity of backgrounds, and they addressed him as master, or Master Han. One might compare the historical background of Confucius, in part to foreshadow some of the things that we'll be looking at after the break, to that of Machiavelli. We find in our historical introduction to Machiavelli that there's a similar type of political background to the development of Machiavellian thought. Small states in Italy fighting for their survival, competing against one another, and leading to more deep questions about legitimacy of political order and what type of political regime is the best. Both Confucius and Machiavelli, we might say, developed their reflections based on practical thinking about their own experience in political life. Both Confucius and Machiavelli started life in the bureaucracy, started life in politics as sort of low ministers, you might say, in other words, sort of in a sort of ministerial portfolio, but of one of a relatively lesser status. And then when they both were sort of booted out of politics, that was their time for reflection on politics and on political theory. Now, despite their similar common background, it's interesting to see how different each of their philosophies are. So I guess it leads to more that thinkers can be born and bred and raised in similar political and historical circumstances. That doesn't mean that their theories are going to be the same. And they respond to those particular conjunctures and contingencies as a truth in different ways. So what Confucius and Machiavelli do with that broader climate of political anxiety that characterizes their time and period is very different. So as I said, he had an early life in public service, and as some of the commentaries said, he rose to become a minister of crime, right? It's interesting how we designate political officers. I can't remember the source from which I got this. It's talking about Confucius as a minister of crime. I mean, it would feel more appropriate in our own era to call a minister of justice, right, than a minister of crime. So, but interesting in terms of how you label political officers in terms of the problem rather than in terms of the solution. He resigned at the age of 54. It's not clear why. Is there a failed insurrection? Was there suspicion about his political loyalties? But in any case, it was clear that his options for promotion were very small. So he traveled to neighboring provinces for about 14 years, returned to his state of Lu as an old man, and in his sort of peripatetic existence for those 14 years, again,